All right, let's take a look at another problem from a recent exam. Here we have two different kinds of systems that are initially at the same temperature, pressure, and composition conditions. And we're going to add 100 kilojoules of heat to these two systems. I'm calling them system 1 and system 2. All right, system 1 is a constant volume system, so it has fixed boundaries. We'll add 100 kilojoules of heat to it. All right, system 2 is a constant pressure system, so we have a piston cylinder that will expand after we add heat to it. And we want to basically answer the question of whether T1 is going to be greater than, less than, or equal to the final temperature for the second system. All right, so to answer this, we'll need to do an energy balance for each system. So the first law for a closed system, like each of these systems where no mass is crossing the boundaries of the system, is delta U is equal to Q plus W. All right, we know that in system 1, that no work is done. There are no moving parts in this system. There's no expansion or contraction of the system because it's constant volume. All right, so the work is zero, and therefore delta U sub 1 is equal to this 100 kilojoules of heat that we've added. All right, so that heat entirely goes to raising the internal energy of the system. All right, if we look at system 2, it has the same basic form of the energy balance, but in this case, as we add energy to the system, we're going to expect that we can actually push up on the cylinder. All right, as we increase that internal energy, some of that will actually be transferred to the surroundings in the form of doing work on the surroundings. All right, and so because we'll push up on this cylinder, then the system is doing work on the surroundings, and that's taking away from the internal energy. It takes energy to do work. And so therefore, this work term is negative because of the expansion in volume. This term is still 100 kilojoules. Right, and so the bottom line is that delta U sub 2 will be some number less than 100 kilojoule. All right, and so we know that the internal energy goes up by less in system 2 than in system 1. And so therefore, in the final state, U sub 1 is going to be greater than U sub 2. And the question is, how does this correlate with temperature? Okay, if this was an ideal gas, all right, then U is only a function of temperature and not of pressure. All right, and therefore, if you had a higher internal energy in tank 1 than in tank 2, you would also have a higher temperature in tank 1 than tank 2, because U is directly proportional to temperature. All right, in this case, though, we're given that it's a non-ideal gas. Okay, and the question is whether that is going to affect our conclusion that T1 is greater than T2. All right, and it turns out that it doesn't affect that. All right, U can be a function of both temperature and pressure. All right, in this case, we expect when we add the energy to tank 1 at constant volume, that's going to have the capability to increase the pressure. All right, it might not increase it in a directly proportional way like we would expect for the ideal gas law that when we increase that temperature. But as we add energy to the system, we're going to expect the pressure to go up in a constant volume system. All right, in the case of tank 2, the system can expand, and actually the pressure won't go up at all. It will be the same pressure that we started with. And so therefore, P1 is going to be greater than P2. Now, typically, the internal energy, which for a non-ideal gas can be a function of pressure, as the pressure goes up, then typically the internal energy, if we're operating at fixed temperature, will go down. So gases at higher pressures but the same temperature have a lower internal energy. Or you can see this if you look up data, for example, in the steam tables. And the reason for this is that gases at higher pressure interact with each other more frequently. All right, and when they experience these interactions, those interactions are actually attractive and they stabilize the system. All right, so gases will tend to interact with each other to lower the internal energy of the system. All right, and so we would expect, based on pressure effects alone, for the internal energy of the system to be lower. But that's not the case. We know already that the internal energy of system 1 is greater than the internal energy of system 2. And to compensate for that, the temperature must be higher, because as we increase temperature, we increase internal energy. And so it actually is not the case that if we have a non-ideal gas, that ultimately affects our conclusion. We still find that T1 is greater than T2. And I should point out that for gases under most engineering applications that we look at, the temperature effects on internal energy will be much, much greater than the pressure effects on internal energy.